Hi, I'm John Tickles, and welcome to Remote RPGs. Well, it's time for the other two Mega Man Starforce games to get their due. Why don't they each get their own review? Well, because, to be honest, I'd be repeating the same thing over and over again. I'm not gonna lie to your face. Santa Claus probably isn't real. Also, these two sequels don't change a lot, so I'm gonna tackle them both, starting with Mega Man Starforce 2. Of course, IGN rated this game a 5 out of 10, saying it's pretty much Battle Network 8. Well, shit, I ranted about them enough in the last review. This sequel takes place a few months after the first, with our hero, Geo, patiently awaiting his new Star Carrier iPhone 2007 billion whatever. Upon getting through our classic tutorial, we find that Geo is now well adjusted, nowhere near as cold as before, but still getting used to spending time with his friends. However, when visiting the Cyber Mall, the group goes to a cyber movie theater where people are attacked by cyber goat.
We get it! You're from cyberspace!
Geo and Mega, of course, save the day, but not before finding out about a new organization planning to take over the world by reviving the ancient continent of Mew. It's up to Geo and Mega to combat this new threat using the power of the tribes in order to stop this evil plot and save the world. In terms of story, the game is pretty well average. There's no longer a need to focus on Geo's development anymore, so the game gets back to its basic Battle Network silliness, nowhere near as dark or gritty as the original. In that way, I'm kinda disappointed. There really isn't much to hate or praise here. It's on par. I partially judge a game by how it makes you feel, what emotional impact it gives you, and how you remember it because of this. I'm sorry to say that, at least story-wise, this game just didn't do much for me. Playing it now, I couldn't even remember the villain at all, or even some key plot points. So, story-wise, it ain't doing much, but there is one memorable thing, and that's Solo. Yeah, Solo is your typical rival character. So what if the name Solo is supposed to put an emphasis on being a loner in a game about friendship? He's friggin' Solo, he doesn't even give a shit! Yeah, I need a little competition in my games. Oh, I gotta keep the eye of the tiger! Oh, I gotta go for a workout. I'm sorry, but my mustache alone requires 20 chin-ups. Unfortunately, Solo is really the only noteworthy additional character. Although, I forgot to mention the legendary Master Shin before, who is legendary, though you can't catch him. Gameplay-wise, yeah, not too much to talk about either. Apparently reviewers complained a lot about the little voice on the menu that announces what you picked, because that was such a big problem, but that was fixed here, I guess, if you count it as fixed. A real cool thing is that now you get two save files in the game, which is awesome if you have a brother or someone, and I don't know why it wasn't included in any of the other games in the series. Speaking of brothers, yeah, that was clever. The brother band system is a little more well developed now, with the ability to make your own portrait, which I pride myself in. Yes, dashing. dashing indeed. Also, the online battle component was really friggin' fun again this time around, though I always got my ass handed to me online. In terms of the battle system, not too much has changed. You get the addition of star cards, which are powered up extra based on the stars you have, and only 4 favorite cards to battle with, which leaves the roulette a little less to chance, but the coolest addition by far is the tribes. There are only 2 versions of this game this time around, Sauron Zerker and Ninja Zerker. The Sauron is a fire-based dinosaur one, like Charizard, so I usually pick it by default. Zerker is a thunder knight of sorts, and the ninja, believe it. With brother bands, you can also have the double tribes, which combine tribes for different combos, or even become the tribe king for some real power. It all depends on the relationships you have, like if you have a brother who's a ninja and then you're a dinosaur, you can make a ninjinosaur. Oh, that's gross. Overall, the battle system isn't much different from its predecessor, but it's still solid and there were a few welcome changes that still keep it fresh. In terms of graphics, what the hell? No, they're not bad, but what they're doing, this whole side series is okay. Look at the graphics from the first 3 Battle Network games. Now look at Battle Network 4, 5, and 6. Okay, so the sprites went from bigger and, I guess, more realistic to smaller and more detailed anime-like. Now look at Starforce 1 to 2. Why? Why does it look that way? Why would you have it one way, change it, then change it back after 4 games? It's just weird. Other than that, the graphics are pretty good, though I think the DS can do a lot better. The locations were very well done, with a bigger focus on nature, and I think this was a nice change of pace. The music is again par for the course, nothing amazing, but some of those battle themes were fantastic. In conclusion, Starforce 2 took some steps back and some steps forward. If you like the original, it's still pretty good, but I can definitely see why some people see this as a copy and paste sequel. That's not to say it isn't a good game, I just wish they took a little more time and chances with it. Its sequel, though... Mega Man Starforce 3 is the last game of the series, at least for now, and it's a solid wrap to a solid series. Coming in either Black Ace or Red Joker, it follows the adventures of Mega and Geo, who get wrapped up in yet another plot. Now, people have another new form of technology merely months after the last thingamajig. Seriously, I don't know if this is some kind of social commentary making fun of consumers and technology, or if this is a joke because they threw a friggin' new game out every year. The new beings are called wizards. Yeah, not a new name though. Wizards are artificial beings who function by helping people with their emails or even fighting viruses. Hold on a second, aren't those just net navvies? If they existed 200 years ago, they aren't new if you just put a new name on it. The wizards are being corrupted by a form of energy called the noise. Insert Grinch joke here. And it turns out that this is all actually being done by a crime organization called Dealer, who are trying to make the meteor hit the planet, because they also played Illusion of Gaia in Final Fantasy VII and wanted a badass original plot. It's okay though, because our dad's Bruce Willis. Anyway, the story of this one is a little better. It feels darker than the second game, a little more serious around the edges, but it still knows when to stay silly and stupid. There really aren't even any new, memorable, or interesting characters, which is kind of a shame, but the core group gets a little more development, so that's all fine and dandy. A new, cool element of the plot is that Geo becomes a friggin' commando to help fight this organization, and there's also a little cool minigame where you have to defend the base from an enemy attack. So, the story has some neat little twists here and there, but again, I think it pales in comparison to the first. And it is kind of a return back to the silliness of the Battle Network days. I don't even have to talk about the exploration and everything, right? You get the idea. Reviewers seem to really hate the idea, and I need an idea how to get rid of my mother-in-law. Oh yeah, review first. Let's just jump into the battle system, because I think this is where the biggest and, well, really only improvements came. Firstly, the way you choose cards is slightly different. There's a return to the almighty program advances, and later, the noise you have to fight. World ends with you, anyone? Depending on how you defeat enemies, your noise ratio will rise, giving you the ability to take on new forms. What's cool about that is that it takes real skill. You have to be good at using your mega attacks and countering well in order to unlock the new perks, like the Black Ace mode or playing as former bosses. However, getting your new big bad form takes a lot longer and it's a little tougher than usual, which is rather frustrating when you really want or need to use it on a whim, but when you do get it, it feels so good! Overall, the battle system in Mega Man Starforce 3 combines the best of not just the Starforce games, but even the Battle Network series to form the battle system that I would call the best. There's really nothing to talk about with the graphics and sound. Again, par for the course. To wrap it up, the sequels of Mega Man Starforce are both strong, but I kind of began to understand why critics attacked these games more harshly. The first one, I think it's easier to defend, and the second one took a step forward, but then it took two steps back. And the third was a better effort, but again, neither of them take as many chances, or in my opinion, are as good as the first. That's mostly complaining story-wise, because the battle system was improved in both games. I can easily recommend this game to big fans of the first and newcomers to the series. I just really wish they put a little more time into the sequels of one of my favorite games, and although I think that they were a little too harsh, the critics of the series do have kind of a right to attack these games for having the same core gameplay 9 times, although, again, that doesn't seem to stop them with Call of Duty, or Pokemon, or hell, even the other Mega Man games. It's a real shame that this was the last game in the series. It has an ending that was satisfying, but I'd be lying if I said I wasn't hoping for a Starforce 4, or at least another shot at a Mega Man action RPG. Right now, Mega Man seems to be stuck in kind of a limbo, but hopefully, with his return to Super Smash Bros. Brawl, he will give us another good console game, or even another RPG handheld like this. And hopefully, it'll be an RPG that won't ever have to appear on this show. That's all for now. I'm John Tickles, and I look forward to our next random encounter.